Greetings. This is the first video in a series to teach those who call themselves Muslims what the Trinity is. As I've said in another video, Mohammedans often hurl the argument the word Trinity is not even in the Bible. And if you wish to argue at their level, the perfect retort is, neither is the word Islam, the word Quran, or the word Allah. But that general level of foolishness, while seemingly acceptable for the Islamic Dawa, is inappropriate for the accurate representation of God's true Injil, the message of salvation to mankind. So let's talk about the Trinity, giving honor to God by using the brains He gave us. God is all-knowing, all-wise, and all-powerful. The first thing to understand is that words are created. In the West, we have an expression, to coin a phrase. This means to make an expression that will be reused for a particular meaning. And the phrase, to coin a phrase, is an example of just such a phrase created to communicate a common principle. Words are also created to communicate. Words are created to represent concepts. Words are created to efficiently convey information. And when a new concept occurs in human understanding, the first thing humans do is attempt to describe it. First, humans will describe the new concept using words they already know. Then they will attempt to create a new word to encapsulate in a single item the meaning or description they have just formed. The description is the definition of the new word. This is most often seen in science, where new concepts are often created. But the basic point to realize is that words are created to represent concepts. That is basically why the word Trinity was coined. So before moving on, I want to make sure you understand that words are a human necessity. We make words so that we can communicate. Before going further, I want to ask you to consider, does God make up new words? Or does God use human words we know? I want you to consider the following. God cannot use new or unknown words without giving their full definition, or His message is meaningless nonsense. What would we do if a prophet came and said, God says you must blagglesnorp? Huh? What's blagglesnorp? Exactly. Which reminds me of Alif Lam Mim, but that is a topic for another video. Christians, if you have never opened a Quran to read and comprehend the nature of the problem facing the world, the comment about Alif Lam Mim will mean literally nothing to you. These Arabic letters are sprinkled at the start of various surah in the Quran. They mean absolutely nothing. And because they are meaningless to humans, they are claimed to be proof of its divine origin. But let us move on from the language lesson. God has revealed Himself to mankind. God has spoken through the prophets, first that He is God, and then later, gradually, God revealed more details about Himself. This concept is called progressive revelation. In fact, God's message is much more than, I am God, worship me, which seems to be the Islamic definition of what God must say to be God. If God does not say, I am God, worship me, then God is not God, at least according to Islamic argumentation. But I digress. God had to reveal himself to mankind using words mankind knew. And over the course of 4,000 years of God revealing aspects of himself, humans coined the word Trinity. Humans coined the word Trinity to attempt to communicate efficiently the three forms by which God has revealed himself. Now, many attempts to describe God use the word persons, as in three persons, but I find this word potentially confusing. Realize there is nothing sacred about the word persons. By nothing sacred, I mean that the Word of God does not say God is three persons in exactly those words. It was applied to attempt to represent in human language the mystery of God's three unique and distinctive identities. I find the word identities useful to describe God's manifestations of himself. But I also find forms or manifestations to convey useful information. The three parts of God is another way, in human speech, to attempt to nuance the unity of three uniquely identifiable character sets. And this is where rational, mature thinking is required to begin to learn and understand about the Trinity. So let's take a look at how God revealed himself and see why the need for such a word, Trinity, arose. Starting at the beginning is always a good place. Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God, the Hebrew word is Elohim, created the heaven and the earth. Elohim is a word that allows plurality. It does not enforce singularity. Taken from the wiki page, Elohim is a grammatically singular or plural noun for God or gods in both modern and ancient Hebrew language. When used with singular verbs and adjectives, Elohim is usually singular, God, or especially the God. When used with plural verbs or adjectives, Elohim is usually plural, gods or powers. Notice that Elohim can be a plural noun, and that even when it is used with singular verbs, it is usually singular. Usually is a word that allows for not always. There are cases when Elohim used with a singular verb is still a plural Elohim. So here in Genesis 1:1, God has already begun by using a word that is ambiguously singular or plural. The revelation of God by his prophets continues to use ambiguous references. Throughout the Old Testament, God mentions the Spirit of God, also called the Holy Spirit. In Hebrew, Ruach HaKodesh. Genesis 1:2, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. We can see that right away God has used the phrase Spirit of God, even though we would be confident this is God performing the act of creation. But God has chosen to not say, and God moved, meaning God moved upon the face of the water. So even in the first chapter of the first book, God has already begun to use references to himself that imply more than a singularity. God, by using the term Spirit of God, demonstrates that in his view of himself, he sees the Holy Spirit as something uniquely and independently addressable. Exodus 31:3. And I have filled him with the Spirit of God in wisdom and in understanding, and in knowledge, and in all manner of workmanship. Psalm 51:11, cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Isaiah 59:19, so shall they fear the name of the Lord from the west, and his glory from the rising of the sun. When the enemy shall come in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord shall lift up a standard against him. Isaiah 61:6, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord hath anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. He hath sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to them that are bound. Isaiah 63:11, then he remembered the days of old, Moses and his people, saying, where is he that brought them up out of the sea with the shepherd of his flock? Where is he that put his Holy Spirit within him? So throughout the Old Testament, God revealed his Spirit as a unique manifestation. And yet all references to the Ruach HaKodesh carry the same reverence as shown to Yahweh, or Jehovah God. Matthew 3:16, and Jesus, when he was baptized, went up straightway out of the water, and lo, the heavens were opened unto him, and he, John, saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lighting upon him, meaning Jesus. Here we read that John, who Islam calls Yahya, saw the Holy Spirit descend and land on Jesus. Then Yeshua, or Issa, continued to teach about the Holy Spirit. Matthew 12:28, but if I cast out devils by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God is come unto you. Mark 3:28, verily I say unto you, all sins shall be forgiven unto the sons of man, and blasphemies wherewith soever they shall blaspheme. But he that shall blaspheme against the Holy Ghost has never forgiveness, but is in danger of eternal damnation. Luke 12:10, and whosoever shall speak a word against the Son of Man, this means Jesus, it shall be forgiven him. But unto him that blasphemeth against the Holy Ghost, it shall not be forgiven. Remember, this is Jesus talking. This is the true Injil. This is Jesus' message in his own words. It will be forgiven if you speak against Jesus or curse Jesus, but not if you blaspheme against the Holy Spirit. Jesus called speaking against the Holy Spirit to be blasphemy. O Mohammedan, do not read this and use Islamic definitions. O Mohammedan, do not read this and think, ah, Mohammed is the Holy Spirit, so do not speak against Mohammed. Jesus did not say, to speak against Mohammed is to speak blasphemy. To understand the true Injil, you must use definitions from the true Injil to define what the true Injil is saying. Islamic definitions are useless to explain the true Injil. Let's look at some more examples of mentions of the Holy Spirit in the true Injil. The one whom God sent speaks the words of God, because God does not give the Spirit in limited measure to him. The Holy Spirit was given to Jesus without limit. Romans 8:9. But you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of God dwells in you. Now if any man has not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. Romans 8:14. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. You see, throughout the Scriptures, God has revealed the Holy Spirit in a very precious way. Jesus himself protected the Holy Spirit. Jesus said the Comforter would teach them all things and lead them into the truth. And as time passed, righteous men, filled with the Holy Spirit, understood the three-part nature of God. The Trinity is one of the things the Holy Spirit has revealed to the hearts of those who love God and love the truth. If you call yourself Muslim, you do not know the Comforter. But the Comforter wants to bring you the message of the true Injil. The Holy Spirit was sent to teach believers all things, and He has. This includes the Trinity. We have seen that the word Trinity was created by men to represent a concept. And we have seen why the concept even existed. God revealed the Holy Spirit as being God, but unique and identifiable. The next few videos will teach more about the Trinity and how the concept was obvious and needed a word to describe it. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.